Good evening. Welcome to Calvary Chapel. And turn your Bibles to Revelation chapter 1. I guess you can start there. And, I don't know that the timing of this series could be any better. We've been kind of experiencing our own little snowpocalypse, right? And ready for that to end. I mean, if anything's going to end. I know we've been stuck. We've canceled. This is the fourth session we've had since December 7th. So that's how bad it's been. It's been crazy. We've dug people out. We've been slipping and sliding. And pretty much all the buildings have collapsed by now. And I hear the kids saying, "I hate snow." Now, you know, when the kids are saying, "I hate snow," that it's time to be done. But I feel that way sometimes, too. Man, just somebody stop this ride. I just want to get off, you know, when it just comes to life. You know, things just can be so crazy. Things can be so difficult. And sometimes we go through those times where we're hard-pressed, and yet we have this feeling that Jesus could come back at any moment. And as we looked at this session two, it's a catalyst for us to keep going. Not that we somehow, and this is important to say, and I just want to preface everything with this, not that we somehow think that Jesus is going to come back and I'm going to be able to escape all my responsibilities and not, you know, pay my bills. You know, we should never have that attitude. I think some people might. And not to say that we don't think that bad things can happen to us while we live on this earth, right? We're all pretty aware of that, right? The bad things can happen. In fact, horrible things can happen to peoples, to nations, and we've seen it, and it can still happen. So, but we do keep our eyes looking for Jesus so that we can keep our focus in the right place. Living for Him, setting our eyes on things above and not on things of this earth. Isn't that what Paul told us in Colossians? Set your mind, set your heart, set your eyes on things above and not on things of this earth. So tonight we're mostly going to be looking at the book of Revelation. And it is a confusing book, but you'll be glad to know that Jesus Himself, in the book of Revelation, gave us a nice little outline for the book. And so we're going to be kind of following this outline. It's really what I wanted to talk about tonight, the main thing I wanted to talk about. And I'm hoping to get done quickly so that we can have some question and answer. But Jesus speaking to John, of course, the book of Revelation was written by the Apostle John. And as he's writing to him, Jesus is talking to John and kind of giving him some instruction. And it starts out with Jesus, you know, appearing to John on the island of Patmos. And he kind of sees this whole vision of things. And Jesus says to him in verse 19, if you look in 1:19, he says, "Write the things which you have seen, the things that are, and the things which will take place after this." And so he uses some prepositions there to talk about the things that were, things that they've seen, the past, the things that are, the present, and the things that will take place after the present things, so the future. And so he gives us this nice little outline. And in chapters 2 and 3, so chapter 1, we see John's vision of Jesus amongst the candlesticks, right? And he tells us that's the seven candles, lampstands are the seven churches, and each of the stars is the seven angels, each one angel of each church, or the messenger of each church. And then chapters 2 and 3, we see the things that are. And in this section, Jesus is writing seven letters to seven different types of churches. The churches that were getting caught up in the world, those who are struggling to stay true to Jesus in spite of the world. And of course, you see the churches he says in each one. You know, some he says good and bad things. There's a few churches he only says bad things to. And there's a few churches that do great, and he only says good things to. And he goes through all these churches, and yet giving them, in a sense, a Christian report card. And really, any church, you know, if you think about the churches that exist today in the world, and individual Christians that exist today in the world, these report cards that he gives, these seven report cards, are for us. You know, so as we read those seven letters to the seven churches, he gives us a couple, clues. First, he says, let him who has an ear So that would be the individual, right? Everybody has an ear. I see you guys all have ears. Everybody says, that's it's talking about you. Let him who has an ear. And the idea behind that is if you have a stomach for it, or if you're willing, you know, to listen. What the Spirit says to the churches, he says that at the end of every letter. And so he's not just talking to that individual church in that day, but he's talking to that individual church in that day, and every single church that will ever exist, every church family, because these are churches in different towns, right? Every church family that ever exists is going to fall into the category of one of these seven churches. And so too, you as an individual Christian will probably fall into some of the pitfalls and some of the blessings of some of these churches. And so we have to be aware of those things that Jesus is telling to us. And yet to the church of Philadelphia, specifically, his promise relates to what the Bible calls the blessed hope or the rapture of the church. Now, before we look at that, let me briefly explain. The rapture is an event in which Jesus Christ himself, and this is an important clue, Jesus Christ himself will come and take his church from the earth. Believers all over the world will disappear, and the graves will bust open, and bodies will be taken up into the clouds, into the sky, and they will be with Jesus in heaven. And this is what's described in the Bible. We'll look at some verses on that in a little bit. We did talk about that pretty extensively in chapter 1, but we'll look at it a little bit more. But this differs vastly from the second coming of Christ. Because in the second coming, the Bible tells us that Jesus comes, Jude chapter 1, or Matthew chapter 25, with 10,000s of his saints, or all his holy angels with him, right? And so in one event, it says, the Lord himself shall descend, and people will rise up. In the other event, the glorious appearing, or the second coming, Jesus comes with all of his saints back to the earth and sets his throne upon throne upon the Mount of Olives, and then he judges the nation. And so it's a very, very different thing. Interestingly, as Jesus writes these seven letters to the seven churches, he talks about the rapture. And he speaks of this to the church of Philadelphia specifically. He says this, as he says to them, I set before you an open door, and then he promises them, verse 10, because you have kept my command to persevere, I also will keep you from the hour of trial, which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. And so as you see that, Jesus is giving them this promise that there's going to be a time that's going to test everyone who dwells upon the face of the earth, and that the church of Philadelphia specifically will be kept from that time. And that's an interesting promise. As you leave chapter 3 and move into chapters 4 and 5, you begin to see the 70th week of Daniel. We talked about that last time, so if you didn't listen to number 3, that one talks about the 70th week of Daniel, a time, or, and when I say week, 70 weeks, that's what the angel Gabriel told Daniel, 70 weeks are determined for your people, Daniel, and your holy city, right? So who are we talking about? We're talking about the Jews specifically, not Christians, but Jews specifically, and the holy city of Jerusalem. God gave them 70, the Hebrew is Shabuah. And not to over-explain this again, because we talked about all this last time, but 70 weeks of years, not 70 weeks like 70 periods of 7 days, but 70 periods of 7 years. So 490 years in all. And from Daniel chapter 9, verse 24, to Daniel chapter 9, verse 26, 69 of those weeks, or 483 years, has been fulfilled from the building of Jerusalem to the Messiah, the Prince. And it was fulfilled on April, I think it was 6th, 3380 or something like that. I mean, Sir Robert Anderson was a scholar, and he was knighted for his work figuring out the day that Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a donkey, presenting himself as the Messiah. Of course, the people rejected him, and it tells us in verse 27 in Daniel 9 that the Messiah shall be cut off. Now, we see that same phrase in Isaiah 53, that he was cut off from the land of the living. He shall be cut off, but not for himself. In other words, he's capitally punished, but for somebody else. Who was he capitally punished for? For us. He died for our sins. And then the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and the sanctuary, and then we'll be with the flood. And then, so that basically speaks of the 70 AD when Titus Vespasian came into Jerusalem destroyed Jerusalem, slaughtered, you know, hundreds of thousands of Jews, and basically turned the land of Israel into Philistia or Palestine. You know, just basically, you know, just hatred for the Jews, and the Jews were pretty much driven out, and they've been out of their land for 2,000 years. But he gives another promise. He's saying, but then the people of the prince who is to come shall destroy the city and sanctuary, but then he is going to confirm a covenant with many, or a treaty with many nations, is what that means, for 1 week, that last week, which happens to be how many years? 7 years. So that, and we talked about this extensively last time, and I've probably gone too far today, but that 7 years is what we would consider the seven-year tribulation. Some people don't like to call it that. The last half of it is the Great Tribulation, but we'll call it the 70th week of Daniel, or the tribulation period. It's a seven-year period of time where basically God is going to do something very specific, deal with Israel and Jerusalem. And that's it's his promise to them. It's his fulfillment to promise to them. And that's why it says in Romans chapter 11 that when the fullness of the Gentiles has come in, then all of Israel will be saved. And we talked about that, and there's several verses that confirm that all of Israel will be saved probably well before the middle of the tribulation. By the middle of the tribulation, they're obeying Jesus, right? He writes words for them to obey, and they obey him. And so they'll be saved before the middle of the tribulation. This is why, and this is one of the main reasons why, it is very problematic for the rapture of the church to happen any time after the tribulation starts. Because the Jews will be the major players in the millennial kingdom. When Jesus comes back to establish his kingdom, there'll be 1,000 years where Jesus reigns on the earth. We will rule and reign with him, the Bible tells us. But the people who make it through the seven-year period are going to repopulate the earth for that millennial kingdom. And people will live for 1,000 years and all that. I know this, if you're just joining us on Facebook and you're not a Christian, you're thinking, what in the world are you talking about? This is, I know, it's a lot to take in. But, yes, it is a Christian doctrine that the church will be taken off the earth, raptured, before that time comes. And we'll discuss that. So, 70th week of Daniel is what the book of Revelation talks about, starting in chapters 4 and 5. And so basically, until Jesus comes back, from chapters 4 and 5 until Jesus himself returns to the earth, that is a seven-year period that the book of Revelation encapsulates. And the first half of it is the time of sorrows, the second half of it is the Great Tribulation, and in those two periods, the Bible tells us, it makes sure that we know, 42 weeks, 1,260 days, it breaks it down into months, weeks, everything, you know, basically, you know, the whole thing, that first half and the second half are broken down for us, so we can't mistake it, because we like, you know, people like to take, you know, days and make them years, and he doesn't, you know, the Holy Spirit does not want us to mistake that it's exactly 3.5 years, and the first half is 3.5 years, the second half is 3.5 years, making 7 years of this treaty that this Antichrist will make with many nations to bring peace, it would seem at first, but then in the middle of the tribulation, breaking that peace and claiming himself to be God in the temple in Jerusalem, which has not been built yet, but maybe that treaty will allow that to be built. Anyway, I digress. Everyone who is dwelling on the earth at the time of that seven-year period, the Bible says they will fall into a snare, right? I mean, it doesn't matter. I don't care if you are a believer, and maybe you've believed at that point, but if the rapture happens and you are left, you are caught, the Bible says, in a snare, and it will be a devastation that will come upon every single person, without exception, that dwells upon the face of the earth. This is what Jesus says. It says in Luke chapter 21, verse 34, "But take heed to yourself, lest your hearts be weighed down with carousing and drunkenness and the cares of this life, and that day come on you unexpectedly." And this is talking about the day of the Lord. It's talking about that seven-year period. He says, "For it will come as a snare to all those who dwell on the face of the whole earth." He doesn't say, oh, well, some people are going to be protected. Some people are going to have an easy time. It is not going to be easy for anybody. Now, I am sure that there have been times, you think of like the Rwanda, or you think of, you know, some of these atrocities that have happened, you know, the killing fields whatever that country is. I'm sorry, that's awful. Yeah, Cambodia, thank you. I was trying to say something else. Okay, Cambodia, the killing fields, you know, all these awful things that have happened, no doubt were just as bad as some of the things that will happen during the tribulation, but this is going to be worldwide. You know, I mean, America's been pretty isolated from problems. And when the tribulation comes, it doesn't matter where you live. It doesn't matter if you live up in the mountains with guns. It doesn't matter if you live down in the valley. It doesn't matter where you live. If you live in the city, in the country, you are going to be devastated. The whole world will be devastated. There'll be famine. There'll be pestilence. There'll be war. There'll be crimes. Animals are going to be turning on you. And it doesn't matter if you become a believer during that time. You still are caught in a snare. And so it is going to be a very bad thing for everyone who dwells on the earth. He says, watch therefore, and this is what I love. This is one of my favorite verses when it comes to the rapture. Jesus says this, verse 36 in Luke 21. Watch therefore and pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape all these things that will come to pass and stand before the Son of Man. So you have a choice. You can be caught in a snare, or you can escape all these things and stand before the Son of Man. Hard decision, isn't it? No, it's not. So Jesus says you can escape these things. This is what it's going to be like during the tribulation. Revelation 12:12, he says, therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you having great wrath, because he knows he has a short time. Now, this is another thing that is going to happen when the devil comes down to earth, and he's given power to, this is what's interesting. The saints in the tribulation, the people who are believers in the tribulation, it says he's given power to prevail over them. Now that's interesting because Jesus told the church, the evil one cannot touch you, didn't he? And yet for the tribulation saints, they don't have the same promises that the church has. And there's several places you see that. They are never called the church. In fact, it's interesting that in Revelation chapter 3, it's the last time you read about the church in the book of Revelation until the church comes back with Jesus at the very end. And so the entire book of Revelation from chapter 4 until the end, it's very Jewish. And it only uses Jewish terms when it comes to speaking of those who are saints, if you will. So the tribulation saints, different than the Christians. Also in chapter 6, it's interesting. It talks about those who were killed for their faith during the tribulation. And where are they? They're dead. But it says they're under the altar, right? It's an odd thing. And they say, how long, O Lord? You know, are we going to have to be under this altar? How long, O Lord, until you avenge our blood? And he says, until the full number of you come in. Then they can come out from the altar and stand before the throne. But for us as the church, we have a different promise, don't we? To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And so these, they don't have that promise. They're left under the altar until the full number of their brethren who are killed, like they were martyred for their faith, like they were have come in. So a very difference, a big difference between the tribulation saints, those who will believe, and I believe that number will be much larger than any amount of people that have ever gotten saved in the history of the world. There'll be a huge soul harvest during the tribulation period, but they will have, in a sense, different promises and a different future than we will. And those who make it through the tribulation will carry on into the millennial kingdom and repopulate the earth. And they'll have completely different covenants and things than we do as the church. Now, I want you to notice this in chapter 4 because he uses some very familiar language. Notice there in Revelation chapter 4 and verse 1. He says, now after these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven, and a voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up here, and I will show you the things which must take place after this. So he uses an interesting phrase here. This is right here, verse 1, is what is known and what I believe to be the rapture of the church. And let me explain why I believe this is where the rapture takes place. In chapter 1, remember Jesus gave us a simple and clear outline. Revelation 1, verse 19, again, write the things which you have seen, right? Things that he saw in verse 1, Jesus amongst the seven lampstands, a glorious appearing of Jesus. I mean, he had fiery eyes and, you know, shiny. It was very different than what we might see on a wall. Somebody drew a picture of Jesus, very different image of Jesus. But amongst the seven lampstands and the seven churches, which are the seven churches. And then he says, and write the things that are. And you see that in chapters 2 and 3, which is the seven letters to the seven churches. And the churches are in existence at John, in John's time, and they still are today. So those are the things that are, the churches, the seven churches of the church is still there. And the things which will take place, and he uses an interesting Greek phrase, meta tauta, or after these things, or after this is complete. Okay? And so, it's very interesting that in chapter 4, verse 1, he uses the word, very first word, meta tauta. Same word Jesus used. Right? The things that are, or the things you've seen, the things that are, and the things that will take place after these things, meta tauta. And then, 4 verse 1, he starts out with the word meta tauta, after these things. And so he's talking about the church, after the church. And then you never hear the church mentioned again, like I mentioned before, until chapter, I think, 19. Now, he uses it twice. He says, let me show you the things that shall take place after these things. He says that at the end of the verse as well. And so after what things? After the things he's talking about in chapters 2 and 3, right? And so the church is done, and it goes forward. Another interesting thing is you'll notice the same symbol he gave to the church of Philadelphia, an open door. He says, I've given you an open door. And then he sees a door open up in heaven, and then he hears a voice that says, come up here. And interestingly enough, that voice sounding like a trumpet. Now, we also know that there is a trumpet sound, the voice of an archangel, that ushers in the rapture. 1 Corinthians 15:52. In the moment and twinkling of an eye at the last trumpet, for the trump will sound, the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. And then also 1 Thessalonians 4:16-17. And this is where we see the word rapture in the Bible. It says, for the Lord himself, okay, again, not with 10,000s of his saints, but the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. And so, just if you haven't been with us and you haven't heard this explanation, I know this can be very confusing. He said that the Lord will, that God will bring with him those who sleep in Jesus. And so, when Jesus comes back by himself, the bodies will come out of the ground, literally, which seems weird, right? But the bodies will come out of the ground. That's why they bury you with your head facing, your head to the west, so you, when you stand up, you're facing east, right? Because it would be weird if Jesus came back and you were turned around backwards, right? I know. But hey, there's a reason for it. And you know, when as a pastor, I always stand to the west because I don't want to get trampled by the body coming out of the ground, right? Because they're going to rise first and then me. So they go first and then I go. So I don't want to be in the way. Wouldn't want to stand over top of somebody's grave. So basically, when Paul talks about us dying, he says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And yet in chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians, he talks about it. Chapter 5 of 2 Corinthians. He talks about we don't want to be disembodied spirits, because we will be. When we die, if you were to die today, heaven forbid, if you were to die today, you know, you go outside and you slip on this ice out here and phew, it's over, right? Or somebody's car slides through the parking lot. I know, it's awful. But if this were to happen, just waking you up. If this were to happen, your body would be dead on the ground. I would probably do your funeral. And yet your spirit would be in heaven. However, that is not your final state. There will come a day when Jesus comes with trumpet sound, and your spirit will come down and meet your body, which goes up. And yeah, there might not be much left. You might just be a few ashes or whatever, but Jesus is okay with that. He can make it work. And he will transform that ash or that lowly body or like my, you know, aching body into a glorious, muscular, fit. Hey, did somebody say skinny? What? What are you trying to say? Wow. Okay, yeah, skinny. Completed body that is glorious. You know, it's probably going to have landing gear. It's probably going to be multidimensional. I'll probably have a lot more abilities then, and so will you. Whether you were in the grave or whether you are. So the dead in Christ will rise first. Your bodies, there will be a bodily resurrection. Job said, though my body does decay, yet I will stand on the earth in the last days. In my flesh, I will see God. Right? He knew that. Job knew that. And Job, I guarantee you, has decayed all the way down to where his bones are dust by now. Wouldn't you agree? And so don't worry about being cremated or anything like that. Jesus can take whatever's there, and he can turn it into whatever he needs to. The dead in Christ will rise first, and then, notice verse 17, we who are alive and remain shall be raptured. That's what the word there is. It's in the Latin, it's raptured. We use rapture because it sounds better, right? Latin is raptus or whatever the word, I can't even pronounce it right, but it's raptus or whatever. Greek is harpazo. We're going to be harpazoed. Just doesn't have the ring to it, does it? Rapture sounds cool. Harpazo. We could use the English ketchup. The great ketchup. Because that's what it says in the English. Those who are alive and remain shall be caught up. And we don't want to be called ketchup. You know, we don't call it ketchup. So we call it rapture. That's where that word comes from. So the word rapture is in the Bible in the Latin Vulgate. But shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. So there's going to be come a time when the saints of Jesus will be raptured or taken up, and we will be with the Lord. And you'll notice at the end of Revelation chapter 4, verse 1, he says, I will show you things which will take place after these things. Again, this can be interpreted after the things, only after the things that he just talked about, the things of the church. So what's going to take place after the church? Chapter 4, verse 1. And then looking down in verse 5, we see the church before the throne. Notice this, chapter 4, verse 5. And from the throne proceeds lightnings, thunders, and voices. Notice, seven lamps of fire were burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. So the Holy Spirit uses these words, expects us to pay attention, because back in chapter 1, in Revelation chapter 1, verse 20, he says, the mystery of the seven stars which you saw in my right hand are the seven golden lampstands. The seven stars are the angels of the churches, and the seven lampstands which you saw are the seven churches. And so we see the Holy Spirit working in the churches in heaven, chapter 4, verse 5. And then chapter 5 takes the seven churches as we know are represented by the complete church. And the Holy Spirit is a flame of those churches standing before the throne in heaven. And that's an interesting thing, because in chapter 5, we see that we sing the song of the redeemed. You know, it says that we're all standing before the throne. We cast our crowns before Jesus, saying, you alone are worthy to receive all glory, honor, and power. For you, basically, you did it all, Jesus. You know, we get our crown of righteousness. He's like, you did a good job. You followed my instructions. You allowed the Holy Spirit to work through you. Here's your crown. And we're just overwhelmed. We take that crown off and say, no, all glory belongs to you, Jesus. That's beautiful to think about. And so we're going to throw our crowns at him. And then in chapter 19, he comes back and he has many crowns on his head. I love that. So here we are, you know, standing before the throne, and then we sing the song of the redeemed, right? You've redeemed us out of every tribe, tongue, nation, and people by your blood. You know, and just beautiful. Speaking of the, you know, going back to the kinsman redeemer, you know, that Jesus was the one who died in our place, who paid the penalty. Remember, on the day you eat of it, you shall surely die. And Jesus, it tells us in that chapter, that he was the lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. He was the kinsman redeemer, the one who had the right of redemption to buy back what Adam had lost in the Garden of Eden. And so he was able to buy back mankind's loss and bring that whole thing to fruition. Anyway, so we see the same pattern of the rapture described in Isaiah Isaiah chapter 26, verse 19. I love, this is one of my favorite passages about the rapture too, because it's just, it's so detailed, and it just rings of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 and 17. It's almost identical. In Isaiah 26, 19, God says, "Your dead body shall live, together with my dead body they shall arise." Wait a minute, God has a dead body? God is speaking in Isaiah. He says, "My dead body shall rise." Interesting, isn't it? "Awake and sing, you who dwell in the dust." So there, you know, you're just dust, right? "And for your dew is like the dew of the herbs, and the earth shall cast out the dead." Look at that. Think of that description. The earth will cast out the dead. I mean, you're going to see dirt flying up. It's going to be like, poof, 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 you know, all over the cemetery. I mean, that's pretty graphic. Verse 20, "Come, my people." This must be the people who are waiting for the dead in Christ to rise first. He says, "Come, my people, enter your chambers and shut the doors behind you. Hide yourself, as it were, for a little moment until the indignation is past. For behold, the Lord comes out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity, and the earth will not disclose her blood and will no more cover her slain." So we have the dead in Christ rising. We have his people coming and then hiding in their chamber. Now, that is an interesting word, because that speaks of the wedding chamber, doesn't it? And we saw that pattern as the church is the bride of Christ. We see it in Matthew chapter 25, when the 10 virgins hear the trumpet sound of the bridegroom coming. They trim their lamps, speaking of the Holy Spirit, they have oil in their lamps, and they go out and meet the bridegroom, and they're taken and they're in the chamber. And the ones who didn't have oil came and tried to come, and he says, "I don't know you." Interesting. So you see these patterns, they all kind of converge in this. But it's such an interesting thing. You know, if you look at 1 Thessalonians 4, verses 16 and 17, almost identical to that Isaiah 26 passage. Now, I've given you verses on the rapture in session 1. I've told you that the rapture is going to take place before the seven-year tribulation. We discussed imminence in session 2. Now, that one was a little bit tedious because I just read you a bunch of verses mostly, but I probably read you 40 verses that said, "Watch and be ready. You do not know what hour your Lord is coming." He just said that again and again and again. Paul said it, Peter said it, Jesus said it. Everybody said Jesus is coming in a time you're not expecting it. And so we kind of get the idea that Jesus is going to come unexpectedly, right? And that's the biggest proof to me that the rapture will happen before the tribulation period. Because once the tribulation period starts, we know the times and seasons. And he says no one's going to know the day or the hour. And he says in another place, nobody will know the times or the seasons. You know, we can guess, yeah, we're getting close, but we don't know. And if Jesus came today, it would catch everybody by surprise, unless you're watching and ready like Jesus tells you to be. So we talked about that in session 2. And then we talked about God's promises, 7-year tribulation was for the Jews in session 3. Now, in this session, we have outlined the supporting verses, and we have just begun to scratch the surface on all this. I mean, there's so much about the rapture, and yet this is going to be our last session on the rapture. But maybe you have some questions, you can ask those. And I have to be honest with you, there are a lot of people who don't believe in the rapture at all. And I would say, historically especially, that the majority of the church has not believed the rapture. You know, it was kind of a bad thing to say that God is going to come back and bring devastation on the ruling governments of the earth and the Antichrist when the Roman church was the one who governed the earth. It's kind of bad to say, well, Jesus is going to come back and punish the evil government when the evil government is the church, right? And so it kind of fell out of favor and people didn't talk about it. There are several, we talked about that in the first session, if you haven't watched it, several ancient, Ephraim the Syrian, Shepherd of Hermas, several ancient writers, even those who were disciples of Polycarp and knew the Apostle John, who talked about the rapture in their sermons in the early church. And there are several who have. And yet, a lot of people just don't believe the rapture at all. And then there's another group of people out there who believe that the rapture is not going to happen before the tribulation period. Now, this isn't something I'm going to argue with anybody about, you know. And yet, honestly, I think I think it's important to believe that the rapture could happen anytime, not because I want to be right, but because I want everybody to have the same urgency that I have. Because knowing that Jesus could come back at any minute makes me live a different life. It makes me want to not do things. I don't want to be doing certain things when Jesus comes back, right? And so thinking to myself and believing and being convinced, fully convinced in my own mind that Jesus could come back at any time, I live differently. And we describe briefly, you know, that there are other views of this rapture in the first session and why it doesn't work with God's plan for Israel. We talked about that. But there are more pressing reasons to believe in a pre-trib rapture. And I feel like these other verses that ignore Jesus' warnings, these other views that ignore Jesus' warnings that he could be back at any moment could be injurious to a believer. Now, some people just don't care, and that's fine. But I honestly think that having a belief that Jesus could come back at any second purifies you. And I understand why people could have a fascination with going through the tribulation. Same reason why people like to watch scary movies. Same reason why people sign up to join the army. You know, there's kind of an excitement of war and problems and tribulation and happy to survive. You know, and a lot of people are driven by those types of things. In fact, a guy put an ad in the paper that said, I want you to go on this adventure with me. You know, you're likely to die. The pay is horrible. And he had a whole bunch of people sign up. Because people want to live for something, right? And I think oftentimes people think of the excitement of the tribulation. And yet, being excited to go in the tribulation will also make me act differently. In a way against what Jesus warns us. For instance, I might become a doomsday prepper, right? And I'm stockpiling gold and stockpiling guns and, you know, doing all those things. And yet Jesus says so clearly in Matthew chapter 6:19, he says, do not lay up for yourself treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourself treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroys, where thieves do not break in and steal, for where your treasure is, your heart will be also. He also tells us, do not worry about your life, what you will eat and what you will wear. And he talks about the sparrows and how God feeds them, and Solomon in all his glory was not dressed like the grass of the field. And yet your Lord knows what you need. And so to put a mindset in my heart that I need to somehow prepare to go through the tribulation is contrary to everything that Jesus taught when it came to being a Christian and living like a Christian. Turn with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. I think we see a stark contrast or a picture of this in 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. The church in Thessalonica was undergoing some pretty heavy persecution. Persecution that they misunderstood to be the tribulation. Well, Paul was there for 2 weeks. And during that 2 weeks, he talked to them about the Antichrist, the tribulation. He talked to them about the rapture of the church. So, you know, don't let anybody say, oh, well, it's too early to talk about these things to young believers. No, he talked to them right away. But most Christians who have undergone intense persecution have difficulty with the idea of a rapture or pre-trib rapture. And this is why. Maybe they were expecting Jesus to return and things got really, really bad. And Jesus never returned and they saw people slaughtered and they saw people killed. They saw people run over by steamrollers. You know, there's all kinds of things that have happened in the history of mankind that is horrible. And they've gone through intense persecution and tribulation. And so people, because they've been thrown in prison and beaten and those things, they have difficulty thinking about the fact that Jesus is going to come back and not let us go through the tribulation. But the thing is that we have to remember is that Jesus said in John chapter 16, verse 33, in this world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Now, he's not saying there you're going to go through the great tribulation. What he's saying there is you are going to have trials in this life. You are going to suffer persecution and tribulation in this life. It is just going to happen as a Christian. Anyone who lives godly in Christ Jesus, Paul told Timothy, will suffer persecution, right? It's just going to happen because the world hates you, the devil hates you. And this is what Paul told the Thessalonians specifically. In Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 1, he says, and you have to remember, Paul went from Thessalonica down to Athens. Remember, he was only there for a short period of time. Persecution arose. He had to leave. It says, therefore, When they could no longer endure it, we thought it good to be left in Athens alone. So he's like, I just decide I'll stay in Athens and send Timothy, our brother and minister of God and our fellow laborer in the gospel of Christ, to establish you and encourage you concerning your faith. So we knew that we weren't there for more than 2 weeks, and so we sent Timothy to help you because we knew that you were in trouble. That no one should be shaken by these afflictions, for you yourselves know that we are appointed to this. John 16:33, you will have tribulation. He said, you guys should have known, we talked about it when we were there, that you were appointed these afflictions. For in fact, we were told, or we told you before, when we were with you, that we would suffer tribulation just as it happened. And you know, for this reason, when I can no longer endure it, I sent to you to know your faith, lest by some mean the tempter attempted you and our labor might be in vain. So right after he says this to them, that you are going to suffer tribulation in this life, it's going to happen, Jesus said it was going to happen, right after he comforts them concerning those who had fallen asleep, because they thought, you know, some of these people got killed, some of these people have died, Jesus hasn't come back yet, does that mean they can't be saved? They had all these questions. But then in 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 and 17, he tells them not to be ignorant of the rapture or worry about those who had died, but to be watching and ready to be caught up, that the dead in Christ will rise first and those who are alive remain will be caught up. So right after that, he tells them that. And then he says this in chapter 5, 1 Thessalonians 5, 6. Therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk, get drunk at night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and as a helmet the hope of salvation. For God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ. You're not going to experience God's wrath, but you're going to obtain salvation. He says, through Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Therefore, comfort each other and edify one another, just as you're doing so. In other words, he's telling them, you're not appointed to wrath. Jesus is going to come back for you. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Encourage one another. Now, I don't believe that I could be a good pastor and tell you that Jesus couldn't come back at any second. I think that that would be foolish of me, because Jesus says, watch and be ready. If I told you, don't worry about watching, Jesus can't come back until this happens or that happens, I would worry for myself, just because the Bible's so adamant about this. I believe that Jesus... Now, some would argue that I'm not a good pastor because I teach that. They have asked me, you're wrong not teaching that you're teaching that the rapture could happen any minute, and what if the rapture doesn't happen, and all of a sudden people are thrust into the tribulation? And he says, this one guy told me specifically, he says, if you do that, he says, what you're teaching is wrong, and it's evil, and it's dangerous. Because they won't have guns stockpiled, they won't have gold stockpiled, they won't have food stockpiled, and they're going to be thrust into the tribulation with no preparation. And my question for him is, how do you prepare for great tribulation and the wrath of God? It is a snare that's going to come upon everyone who dwells upon the face of the earth. Explain to me, how do you prepare for that? Especially in light of what Jesus said, to not store up things on earth, and to not worry about what I'm going to eat, or what I'm going to drink, or what I'm going to put on. It just doesn't make any sense. Now, I'm not saying that it's not wise to have a couple weeks' worth of food in your house. I mean, we all know that. We could have experienced the Vinpocalypse, you know, and Vin Crosby is telling us it's going to be 5 days before you can get food. Everybody went and bought all the milk in town. I'm not opposed to that. I think it's smart to have enough food to last a week if you're snowed in or something, or a month even. But, you know, are you storing up treasure? Or you think you're going to survive the tribulation? I think that's crazy. But the guy told me, well, people are going to lose their faith when they find out you're wrong. Now, somehow I doubt that Bible prophecy being fulfilled all around them, it's apparent that we're in the tribulation, that the Bible is true, that Pastor Mike was wrong, but we're in the tribulation, that all of a sudden they're like, well, we're in the tribulation now. I hate Jesus. I don't think that's going to happen. Just saying. I think that they're going to be even more convinced, right? Okay. They see God firsthand, his word being fulfilled. Doesn't sound like a recipe for people losing their faith. Maybe they'll lose their faith in me, but that's okay. On the other hand, I tell someone that Jesus can't come back now, human nature, I don't know how you are, but I know how I am. Human nature is, oh, Jesus can't come back yet? Well, I guess I'll kick back. I have more time. I have more time to repent of my sin. I like this illustration. So let's say I told you, I'm going to come pick you up at your house. I don't know what time I'm going to be there, but I am going to drive up to your door sometime between 8 a.m. and 5 p.m. You better be ready. Because if you're not out in the car within 2 minutes, I'm leaving without you, right? And so I drive up to your house, honk the horn, you come out with your suitcases, right? You're ready because you knew I could come at any minute. You packed the night before. On the other hand, if I say, I'm going to drive by your house, honk twice, and then I'm going to drive on by, and 2 hours later, I will be there to pick you up on the dot. When are you going to start packing? When you hear the honk, right? Because that's just human nature. We procrastinate. And if we think there's time, we got all the time in the world. You know, Jesus isn't back yet. When you see the signs, then you start worrying about it. That's a dangerous thought to tell people. In fact, Jesus knew that. Jesus would say that in Matthew chapter 24, verse 42. He says, watch therefore, for you do not know the hour your Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house had known the hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore, you also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming in an hour you do not expect. Who then is the faithful and wise servant, who his master will make ruler over his household to give them food in due season? Blessed is that servant whom his master, when he comes, will find so doing. Assuredly, I say to you, he will make him ruler over all his goods. But if the evil servant says in his heart, my master is delaying his coming, and begins to beat his fellow servants and to eat and drink with the drunkards, the master of the servant will come in a day when he is not looking for him, in an hour he is not aware of, and will cut him in two and appoint his portion with the hypocrites. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Pretty serious warning of somebody who says, oh, Jesus can't come back, he's not coming back, and starts to live like hell, starts to live like the world. And then Jesus comes back in an hour that he's not expecting. He gives a similar warning in Revelation chapter 2 and verse 21. He tells the church of Thyatira, I gave her time to repent of her sexual immorality, and she did not repent. Indeed, I will cast her into a sickbed, and those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation, unless they repent of their deeds. I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he who searches the minds and the hearts, and will give to each one of you according to your works. And so this church is given a severe warning. There, you know, and a lot of people will attribute this to the Catholic Church for reasons I'm not going to get into right now. But here's a church who is committing sexual immorality, probably spiritual adultery, idolatry, and they're full of believers. This church is full of believers who aren't believers. They're full of false converts. And Jesus is going to cast them into, he doesn't just say tribulation, he says great tribulation. And that's a phrase that's used concerning those last 3.5 years or the 7-year period. They call themselves Christians, but they're living in sin, not expecting or looking for the coming of Jesus. The last thing Jesus tells us is this. Revelation chapter 22, surely I come quickly. Then John chimes in. Notice he says, amen, even so, come, Lord Jesus. He comes, and the idea of quickly is not, you know, quickly in a period of time, but the idea is unexpectedly. You know, he's coming unexpectedly. He comes as a thief to those who don't know him and as a bridegroom to those who do. And so we have to watch. And that's all I got. Let's pray, and then we'll go with questions. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you're in control, that you hold all of this in your hands. And Lord, I just pray that you would just help us to watch and be ready for you, Jesus. We don't know the hour you're going to come. And I just pray that we would just keep that in mind, that you could truly come at any moment. And Lord, I just pray that we would just be ready, Lord Jesus, when you do come. That you would find us serving you, that you'd find us looking for you, that you'd find us loving you, Jesus, and that our lives would reflect who you are amongst the people that we interact with on a daily basis, that we would have an urgency when it comes to sharing our faith. We'd have an urgency when it comes to getting to know you. And Jesus, we know that we're going to be spending a lot of time with you for all eternity. I pray that we would be ready for that, Lord, as your church, as your bride, as you come to get us. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Jeremiah, will you get that microphone from Sean? And anybody have any questions, raise your hand. You guys have been storing up questions, right? Come on, who's first? Questions, questions, questions. Don't be shy. Okay, got one, Isaiah. Okay.
Okay. Wow. Wow. Matthew chapter 24, verse 22, it says something to the effect of, unless those days were cut short, even the elect would perish, kind of. At least that's what my note says. Uh-huh. So I was curious, if the elect are already taken out, why are the days cut short, type thing?
Okay, so let's talk about that. The elect, and you'll notice throughout the Bible it uses that phrase, elect. And you'll notice in the Old Testament it's considered, the Jews are considered elect. And in fact, that's the big problem of Romans. You know, when we look at the book of Romans, how can the elect not be saved? And that's the big problem in Romans chapter 9, you know, when Paul talks about Pharaoh and everything like that. He's saying, how can the Jews who have followed God their whole life not be saved, and the Gentiles who just said, I believe in Jesus, and they've been living like, you know, pagans, be saved? You know, how can somebody who's been righteous all their life be damned, and a person who's, you know, new be saved? And so the elect is used throughout the Bible. You know, there's God's elect people in the Old Testament, the Jews. There's God's elect church in the New Testament. But in the tribulation, there are also God's elect. Anybody who's saved would be considered God's elect. And so, basically, the tribulation, what he's saying there when he says, if those days were not shortened, even the elect would perish, the idea is that the tribulation is that so many people are going to die, even Christians, or even believers, rather, let's call them believers, will die during the tribulation. If God allowed that to continue on, and continue to pour out bowls of wrath and continue to, you know, let those trumpets sound and continue to break those seals, everybody would die. Even the elect would perish. And so he cuts those days short so that there will be people left to enter into into the millennial kingdom. And so that's what he's saying. So the days are going to be cut short. Not that he's going to end it early, because it will be a full 7 years. But he's going to let it stop, I believe, is what he's saying there. The days will be cut short. And the elect would be those who are believers during the tribulation period. Tribulation saints and the Jews, all the whole Jewish nation. Every Jew is going to believe during that time. So there won't be a Jew on the earth that is not a believer at that time. Next question. Oh, yeah, over here. Oh. You got to talk for the Facebook people.
What is a millennial kingdom?
Okay, the millennial kingdom. Millennium means 1,000, right? And so Jesus is going to come back. Actually, let's look at the book of Revelation. I'm not going to know chapter and verse on this, so. Okay. So. Chapter 20, let's see. Okay, in chapter 19, Jesus comes back. There's a 45-day period from the end of the tribulation until the beginning of the millennial kingdom. And what's going to happen is Jesus is going to come back. He's going to, it describes it in Matthew chapter 25. You've probably read that. Then the Lord will come with 10,000s of his saints. He'll sit on his glorious thrones. He'll gather the nations together. And that's going to be a horizontal rapture. So the earth will be reaped. It talks about it in the book of Revelation. The earth will be reaped, and people from all over the world will be transported from wherever they are to the Valley of Jehoshaphat, which is the Valley of Decision. And Jesus is going to separate the nations at that time. As the shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, he describes in Matthew chapter 25, and he's going to put the non-believers on his left and the believers on his right. And he's going to condemn the non-believers and cast them into the great tribute, or cast them into the lake of fire. So people are going to make it all the way through the tribulation only to be cast in the lake of fire. And then the other ones are going to enter the kingdom prepared. Jesus says, prepared for you from the foundation of the world. That's going to be all the Jews and people from every tribe, tongue, and nation, which will repopulate the earth. And Jesus will sit on the throne of David and rule for 1,000 years. And so it says in chapter 20, then I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the keys of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand, and laid hold of the dragon, that serpent of old, who is the devil and Satan, and bound him for 1,000 years. And he cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal on him, so that he should not deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years were finished. But after these things, he will be released for a little while. And I saw thrones, and they who sat on them, and judgment was committed to them. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for their witness for Jesus and for the word of God, who had not worshipped the beast or his image and had not received the mark on their foreheads or on their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ for 1,000 years. But the rest of the dead did not live again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection. So the first resurrection is the rapture, and those who came out of from under the throne or under the altar, and they reign, live and reign with Christ for 1,000 years. Everybody else enters the kingdom, as we see in Matthew chapter 25, prepared for them for the foundation of the world. They populate the earth again, and then after the 1,000 years is up, Satan is released to deceive the nations one more time. And so that whole time is that Satan is going to be bound for 1,000 years, and basically there's going to be no worldly influence and no satanic influence in the world. And so it's going to be a utopia. It describes it in the Old Testament that they'll turn their weapons into plowshares, that a child will lead a lion by the hand and play with a viper in the viper's den and not be harmed. And the lamb will lay down with it. We hear the lion will lay down with the lamb, but it actually says the lion will, or the wolf will lay down with the lamb. You know, and they'll be peaceful, and the lion will eat straw like an ox. You know, it describes all this in the book of Isaiah. So during that time, the curse, in a sense, will be reversed on the earth. Well, Jesus had purchased back the earth, and that's what the seals were when he broke the seals in the beginning of Revelation. He purchased back the earth. The curse is broken because Jesus has broken it by his blood and his crucifixion. And so it'll be kind of like the Garden of Eden, and the animals will all be gentle, and you'll be able to, you know, hang out with Aslan and whoever else, you know, without any harm. So it's going to be an awesome time for 1,000 years. And then at the end of the 1,000 years, Satan will be released again. And that seems confusing. Why would God, after 1,000 years of perfect, allow Satan to come back out? Well, the reason he does is because there'll be a lot of people who were born during the millennium who didn't know what it was like to live in a fallen world, didn't know what it was like to have deception or sin. And so Satan will come out, and God will give everybody, and that's just, it reinforces the idea that God gives everybody a choice. Because everybody will be, now anybody who made it through the tribulation are not going to be deceived. I guarantee you, nobody who made it through the tribulation period, unless they were a little child, nobody's going to be deceived. But if they're an adult, and they remember what the old world was like, there's no way that they're going to, you know, they believed in Jesus at that point. Those people they're born during the millennial kingdom won't have known what sin and evil is like. And so when Satan comes out and tempts them away from God, some people are going to be like, you know what, I never really cared for God. And they'll go after Satan, and then he'll crush that rebellion. But everybody's going to be, it's the whole idea is that you have to have a choice in order for it to be, you know, God's, you know, God's not going to let anybody into heaven that doesn't want to be there, in other words. You know, people want to rebel against him. So that's kind of, does that answer your question about the millennium? One last question. Crystal. Oh, I got two over here.
Will the mark of the beast be pushed before the rapture of the church?
No. Okay, so if the rapture of the church, I believe no. If the rapture of the church happens at the beginning of the tribulation, it's pretty clear, Revelation chapter 13, which talks about the mark of the beast, which is a mark that will be forced upon men to to receive on their right hand or their forehead, and they will not be able to buy or sell without this mark. And by receiving the mark of the beast, they're giving homage or worship to the beast or the image of the beast. So that's going to happen right after the middle of the tribulation. And that's going to, so basically what's going to happen is the Antichrist will go into the temple of Jerusalem. He will stop the sacrifice and offering. He will cause an abomination that makes, that desecrates the temple, probably setting up the image of the beast, and he'll give life to the image of the beast, so it'll speak. And then they'll force everyone, great and small, to receive a mark on the right hand of their forehead as a token of worship and basically allegiance to the beast. And anybody who receives it, they're damned. Anybody who doesn't receive it could be executed. But that's going to happen in the middle of the tribulation. So if the rapture happens before the tribulation or in the middle of the tribulation, then no. Those who believe that the rapture is going to happen at the end of the tribulation, they believe that they're going to, you have to be careful of the mark of the beast. Okay, Katie, one last one.
I was wondering when you were talking about how the Jews will be all saved during the tribulation, like what about, because Romans 11:25 talks about a partial blindness coming on the Jews currently. Yeah. And so what about the Jews who are living now and might die, you know, not believing? Is there any kind of are they judged differently, you know? Is there any kind of, like, second chance for them?
It doesn't seem so. You know, Paul, he says in Romans chapter 10, right before that, he says, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is they might be saved. They have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. And they won't submit to God's way of righteousness. They're trying to establish their own righteousness. They won't submit to Christ. And then he says that blindness in part has happened. And that was a curse that came upon Israel, because Jesus would look over the city of Jerusalem and he would say, you know, if you had only known this hour, the day of your visitation, I would have gathered you under my wings like a mother hen gathers her chicks. But because you've rejected me, you're going to be desolated. And so he prophesies the rebellion, the crushing of Israel, and that a lot of them just won't be saved. And that's the sad truth. Even during the tribulation, there will probably be Jews who get killed before they get saved. And that's just what's going to happen. But everybody has a choice, you know, and they have a choice to look at the scriptures and to say, you know what, my Messiah is in existence, but their hearts are hardened. It's kind of interesting. He says blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles comes in. That doesn't mean that blindness in full has happened to them. It means that any Jew who really wants to be saved can be, but they just have a bitterness as a people against the Messiah. And so, you know, they're not saved, just like anybody else wouldn't be saved who wouldn't accept Jesus. But then there is that promise right after that, that when the fullness of Gentiles comes in, then all of Israel will be saved. So every single Jew will be saved after the fullness of Gentiles comes in. So it may be that every single Jew who's alive during the tribulation will be saved before they're killed. I don't know. Very possible. All right. God bless you guys.